There was widespread shock and sadness last month when Dolores O'Riordan, lead singer with Limerick band The Cranberries, passed away suddenly in London. In conversation here, through a compilation of some revealing interviews, Dolores comes across as a fascinating interviewee. At the beginning of the 90s, The Cranberries quickly became a headline act in the US and everywhere else, thanks to the group's melodies and Dolores' haunting voice. So, with a journey back to the band's 90s heyday, we get a picture of a complex and articulate woman who, across the globe in a very short space of time, became one of the highest-profile female singers in the world of 90s music, as the band turned dreamy, thought-provoking songs of infatuation and uncertainty into perfectly relatable teen dramas for a generation. Just one of the reasons why the band's songs made so many memorable appearances in some of the most enduring teen movies and TV shows of the decade. By the end of the 90s, album number 4, Bury the Hatchet, marked a new, less hectic chapter in the story of one of the most successful Irish bands ever. Dolores, the album Bury the Hatchet, is it a new beginning? Is it a part two for the Cranberries?
Yeah, definitely, for sure, yeah.
And are you glad to say goodbye to part one in some ways?
Yeah, I am, actually. And it's very funny because when we brought this album out, a lot of people were going, so what happened? So, were you anorexic? Were you bulimic? Were you depressed? And it was like I was an anorexic and I was depressed, yeah. I was overworked. I was sick of being a celebrity. I was sick of not having any sense of reality. Took a break, hung with the girls, discovered what it was to be a woman again. You know, had a baby, got a life, came back, and it's all fun now. So Bury the Hatchet was kind of saying, move on, you know, and let bygones be bygones and start fresh. And it really is fresh. It's kind of like our first album. It was just written about everyday, normal, good old, boring things, but yeah, nice songs, you know.
But was it nice to be back in the studio as well? Was it nice the fact that, like, other albums had taken a lot longer to record and this actually took a lot shorter? Because you just do it. Like, you can try and improve songs, which doesn't really improve.
It was actually lovely when we first went into the studio. Like, well, initially, I remember we pulled out of this tour at the end of, I believe it was 95, it was coming up to Christmas, and I was really thin, and everybody was speculating what was wrong, and it kind of made me feel worse, like everybody was judging me, and they wouldn't leave me alone. It was like, leave me alone, you know. Yeah. So I went off to the Caribbean, and the most bizarre little tiny islands where you get in a plane, and you get in a plane, and you get in a plane that's kind of scary looking, but you end up somewhere where nobody knows you, and nobody says anything, and I kind of really came down. And then when I got pregnant, I was really enjoying the pregnancy, and I got through the scary 3 months, and then into about 6 or 7 months, when I really got comfortable, I started writing songs, and one of the songs I wrote was Shattered, which was kind of about the fears that you go through when you're carrying a child. And then Dying in the Sun was another one where I was looking back at the negative me, the kind of sad period I went through, and I was kind of saying I never want to go back to that, and now I'm moving forward and I'm becoming a happy person like what I used to be always, you know. So I rang the boys and I said, lads, I have a few songs, you know. So they were like, okay, we'll come over to Toronto, into the studio, 7 months pregnant. Huge bump. It was great crack, like, and the boys were all looking at me going, God, it's weird seeing you like this, you know, and it was so much fun. It was really like a new band because I was like a different person, obviously. So, you know, I was inside and we had this guy, Ben Fenner, who engineered a lot of, I think he worked with James and, you know, a lot of...
He did the Wah Wah album with James.
Yeah. He was a really nice guy as well, really laid back and, you know, not kind of heavy or anything. So we were kind of, you know, messing away inside with the cans on, singing away, having a laugh. And, you know, you get this kick and it'd be like, oh, that was a great take. We'd start again after getting a kick again now, you know. So it was like a lot of fun. It was just a really different trip altogether.
Did you feel that after the baby was born that you felt you maybe should go back and do it again because the vocals might be different or something might be different? But you said, listen, the ones we did in Toronto were fine.
Exactly. This is what happened when we were in France. We went back in and I was saying to Ben, I sang this song called Desperate Andy. And at the end, it had a really kind of a roary bit in it, like where you're like roaring your head off, you know. Mm. But with the weight of the stomach, my voice was kind of like, oh, kind of a bit heavy when I roared. And it kind of broke there. And I said to Ben, I'm going to go in and fix that or whatever. And I'm going to sing a verse of this song and that song again. And every time I tried to go back and tamper with it, it was like, no, it's not happening. I just... You know, it's beautiful for what it is, like Shattered and Dying in the Sun. And there's a feeling in the voice that I could never capture again. And that was me with a child. There's a happiness, there's a glow. And you got that glow in your voice too. So it's
But there's a happiness right across the board too. The lads were happy to see you again. It was good to be back in the studio after you all had a break. This guy, Ben Fenner, was cool. He turned out to be a funny guy as well.
Yeah, great crack.
And like the album is a happy album. A bit of satire maybe here and there, but compared to, say, Faithful Departed, it's a different world.
Totally different wavelength, you know.
Suddenly something
And from the end of the 90s right back to the beginning of that decade, the other three members of the band remember how it all began.
It was a Sunday afternoon, I think, and Dolores came in with a keyboard under her arm. She was wearing a tracksuit.
We played some stuff for her that we had. It was just kind of instrumental versions of some songs. And then she sang some songs that she had written.
So just set up a mic stand and keyboard and just kind of ran through some bits and pieces she had, and we just thought it was amazing.
We thought, like, fine, she'd be able to sing. Obviously, otherwise she wouldn't be bothering coming up, but you don't think that you're going to be that lucky, that you're going to find somebody that can sing as well as she could.
They rehearsed, it was just all guys, you know, and it was a very unusual thing for a woman to want to be or to be in the whole rock and roll thing, you know. It was like, she's a girl and they're boys.
She just, like, was looking around kind of a bit freaked out or whatever, naturally, you know. But five or six blokes in a room, you would be a bit freaked.
We knew she could sing, but the equipment we had was so bad that you couldn't hear anything. It was just kind of mumbles, like.
They had to turn down their amps, which was a big kind of thing for them, you know. When guys are like 16 or 18, they like their guitars to be loud. It's a male thing.
We had the music for Finger and Sunday from the first album, just the chord sequences and stuff, so seemed to be quite impressed as well.
I think it was about 6 weeks afterwards we did our first demo.
What we did was made a tape with just the music, and she went off and wrote lyrics, and a week later, Linger and Sunday were almost completed.
And it was then, for the first time, that you could actually hear everything. And for what it was, you know, it was okay.
We started off doing more gigs and started playing every weekend and, you know, rehearsing a lot more. About four nights a week or something we were rehearsing then.
When we got the interest from record companies, the first ever letter, you kind of stop and think, wait a minute, maybe there is something going on here.
I just want to hold you there for the moment, because Dave Fanning, above anybody else, right from the beginning, how you doing, Dave?
How you going?
Backing the Cranberries right from the word go when there were nothing.
And so he was, were loads of people, though.
Indeed, I know that. No, not loads of people. Well, you most especially, when there were nothing, and you were the one who kept on saying they're going to be something, and therefore it is fitting that you have the job you've got to do. Go over there and present.
I will.
Gold thing.
Just before I do present it, I would like to say that Gay has pointed out that the band have sold more debut albums than anybody else in terms of Irish bands. They've sold up to almost 3 million copies around the world. The album made number one in Britain, even a year after its release. But this award specifically, and I have four of them, not one for everybody in the audience, one for everybody in the band, is specifically for Irish sales. In a country of 3.5 to 4 million, whatever, they've actually sold up to about 45 to 55,000 copies. That makes it double platinum. So, the rest is going to be history, I hope, because no need to argue with the new album. It's going to be huge. Gunnery and Bohar Liv Galera, you can clap. I'm going to give this to Lois. Lois, congratulations.
Hold on, I'll just take a
So, over 20 million sales for the first two albums alone, a long way from playing the organ in her local church in Ballybricken in County Limerick.
Do you acknowledge a serious debt then to the way you were brought up in the church in terms of singing, etc.? Or is that just part of your past? But this is what I did.
Yeah, it's just the way I was brought up. I don't think I owe anybody anything, you know. I could have ended up a junkie if I liked. I could have started taking cocaine when I was 16 or whatever, and I didn't, you know. You know, you don't owe anything to anybody, really, I think, except your... Probably you owe a lot to your parents, I think, because they're the ones who kind of psychologically make you what you are when you're 17, 18, you know. And you go out there with a certain amount of strengths in your head about yourself, you know. And you're either going to be weak and fall into things or be strong and say, sure, look, you're going to laugh at me, but this is me. Get over it, you know. I'm going to be here if you like me. Come back, you know.
you know, and I've seen teenagers, like, and young people kind of go for the peer pressure thing. But I think if I just owe anything to anybody, it would be my parents, really.
Well, then what about the opening track on the second album, No Need to Argue, Owe to My Family? I mean, is there an element of that where you might feel that you're missing part of growing up with them?
Yeah, you know, I think every adult, like, it from time to time, you know, you find yourself sitting down, you might be pickled drunk or something, and you might be acting like a kid or something. I mean, people like to escape from reality and from pressures. I think Owe to My Family was just about trying to escape from the pressures of reality and just be a kid again.
By the mid-90s, with sales of over 20 million copies of the first two albums and with constant touring all over the world, the pace had taken its toll.
You probably drove yourself a little bit too far. You probably let it go a bit too far.
Yeah, and I think, though, a lot of the people around me were like, they told, like, I know they love me, but they were like, you know, you can, you'll be okay.
Yeah.
You can snap out of it. Just sit down now and eat 10 potatoes and go to bed and go to sleep and you'll be fine. And I'd be like, but I can't. And I'd be here having my little panic attack or something, you know. Yeah. It was just totally out of my control. And I think a lot of people around me couldn't believe that I was not in control of what was happening to me. They were like, she's stronger than that. But people assume you're so strong. And it's like, I always was very strong. But I think after, like, so many years of doing what I was doing, and I also went through a lot of personal grief, personally, that I can't discuss, like, you know. But I had a lot of kind of, like, demons. I used to have a lot of nightmares. I had a lot of, I had a kind of bad experience once upon a time. So it took a long time for to leave me, you know.
Okay, but Laura, somebody gets into a band. You met these guys in Limerick. They were looking for somebody, and you were looking for somebody too.
Yeah.
You were quite impressed that they were able to write songs, and, you know, it starts off from there. People always want success, I assume. Okay,
yeah.
Uncertain was released around November 91. So for the whole of the 90s, and it was pretty quick. It was quick enough.
It was.
Now, you got huge success in the United States. About 7 million for the first album, 16 million for the next album, or whatever. And one of the reasons is that you toured and toured and toured. You did it in some ways the hard way, the old-fashioned hard
way. Yeah, we did. And, you know, I think we still kind of have that kind of thing. I think the Cranberries are really a touring band.
Sure, but what I'm saying is this, that, like, in other words, basically, you have to kind of sell yourself.
Yeah.
So, like, you're not giving out about the fact that, like, there is a level of where you feel you have to sell yourself. It's just you don't have to sell yourself as slavishly as you did. In other words, if there's a tour now, 3 weeks off every couple of months.
Yeah, I mean, I was crazy. I mean, okay, when you tour, it's like you pack your bags. I was pretty much, I was still in sixth year in Laurel Hill in my secondary school when I joined the Cranberries. I went off touring initially. We used to tour in a little hi-ace van, a bread van, and we did that for about a year, I'd say. And after the gig, I'd kip on their laps. Four of them would let me sleep on their lap while we'd drive to the next venue because I was the girl. It still, it was a bit tough, you know. It's like, I'm the only girl, I'm the only one undies, I'm the only one with the whole female factor stuff, you know. And it was kind of lonely and whatever, but, you know, you got over it, and the boys were my sisters and stuff. Well, I thought they were, you know, type thing.
You had been through an awful lot, and, like, I know that's been documented somewhat in the past, but in a nutshell, could you have broken the band? Could you have said, that's it? Could that have been the answer, like, goodbye, Cranberries?
Well, that's literally what I did when I was really, really, like, it kind of annoys me when you're a woman, and the minute you get a little bit heavy, the media are on you, or if you get a bit thin, you're anorexic or something, and they just harp around about this. they don't read that it could be something deeper, it could be something more, you know. And I remember it was like I hadn't slept for months and months and months, and I would like get shakes and stuff, panic attacks, I guess you call it, like. So there was a lot of heavy stuff going on that I couldn't control, you know. And I guess like when we took that break, I remember I couldn't handle this not doing a gig thing, because I'd done gigs every night of my life for years. I had something to do. The Cranberries was my life. And I was scared to stop. It was like, what will I do if I stop? I'll go crazy. They'll have to put me in a padded cell if I stop doing this. Just the whole idea of stopping and not being in the Cranberries. It was like, what will I do? Like, go for a walk? That would be kind of scary, you know. And I remember like going for walks when we stopped, just going for a walk up the road and kind of looking at things like a flower. And I remember I pulled a flower and I said, I hadn't looked at a flower for about 3 years. Mm. Little simple things like that. I just really got so kind of far away from human things, you know. And I guess because I was brought up in the middle of the countryside in Ireland, in the Golden Vale, in the middle of the fields, I guess that it really affected me badly, being so far away from nature and simple things, you know. Whereas I think other celebrities are, you know, famous people who grew up in big cities, when they're used to hotel rooms and they're used to all that kind of man-made stuff, you know. It was kind of scary as well, because I was surrounded by an awful lot of pressure. Like, the closest people to me were under so much pressure as well. Like, she can't pull the tour, she can't stop singing, she can't be sick. And it was like, but I am. And it was like, shh, we don't want to hear that. Mm. You know, so it took actually a long time to actually get out of it. I was getting worse and worse, though. But by the time we did cancel that tour, I was pretty bad, you know. I was really bad, like I was messed up.
You pulled the tour, were the three guys happy that you did in some ways? And great, I'm glad somebody else didn't get blamed for this, because I wouldn't mind pulling this.
They were, like, they were really unhappy as well. Their wives were on the road at the time as well. So it was like, we hadn't spent any time together before we went on stage. It was like, we'd go on stage and we'd be there just like, oh, hi, how's it going? On stage.
Yeah.
10, 9, 8, 7, curtains open, we do a gig. And during the gig, you'd be looking at each other and we'd be kind of like, God, not enjoying it anymore. Yeah. Because we just didn't take any breaks over the years, and we just kind of got into this rut of just doing this work, work, work. But I could see that Noel missed his wife. I could see that Ferg missed his, you know, I could see the boys missed their girls, and they missed their home as well. And they were all kind of down. And then after the gigs, they'd come off and, you know, they'd go off their separate ways with their wives. So we didn't even talk anymore as a band, you know. We were just kind of, we really needed a career break.
Well, isn't that a good reason to either take a serious break or say, let's just break up the band? Because it's supposed to be fun.
Yeah, it's supposed to be fun.
Were you able to fool the audience? Were you able to, like, give a performance enough that the audience would at least go home and feel that their money was well spent?
Yeah, you can really. It's not really, I suppose, that you're fooling them, but it's like, because you're quite kind of, you don't want to be in a certain situation, say, all day long. But the minute you get on stage, that's your release.
Yeah.
So you would actually get into the performance inevitably. So all your happiness and your sadness and your anger. But I remember I was a lot angrier as a person back then, because I wasn't really happy about my lifestyle and stuff. So I was quite angry as a performer and everything. But now it's like I've kind of gotten in touch with the kind of soft side of myself, and the humorous side has really come back a lot as well. So
okay, getting in touch with the soft side and the humorous side, one thing is taking a lot of time off. Another thing is, like, to be blunt, a lot of Irish people maybe would look at a shrink, a psychiatrist, hold on, that's what people in movies do. We don't do that.
Yeah.
Now, you went to somebody, obviously you were told, look, this is a good thing to do. It was helpful, wasn't it?
Yeah, because it was like, obviously when you cancel a tour as well, it's a big deal with
a $6 million tour, I was told.
I know, God, I was told 220, like, hundreds of times every day, $6 million. It was like, obviously the money is more important than me.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I kept thinking, and it made me kind of, like, have more kind of self-hatred or something, like, well, I'm a piece of crap anyway, just shut up and sing, kind of thing I used to think to myself. Mm. I didn't feel cherished or anything at the time. It was kind of, to me, I suddenly saw, you know, a real side that kind of was horrible, you know. But, you know, we did actually successfully cancel, but I had to go and see a lot of doctors. And I remember, like, I was in this room one day, and my own doctor, since when I was a kid, was there. He was, you know, minding me. There was loads of other doctors, and I sat there, and I was so humiliated. And my husband was sitting inside the door, and I was just sitting there, and it was like, you know, I was sitting there with my kind of, they were taking tests, and I had my brow or whatever on, you know. Mm. And I was sitting there, and I just felt like crap. I was just like, God, all I want is to get out of this. Please leave me alone. And it was like, they were all there, like, poking and listening. Her heart is okay. This is okay. What's wrong with her? And it was like, I just want to get away, please, you know. I'm just cracking up, okay, you know, kind of thing. But, okay, we'll send her to a psychiatrist next. So they did. And he was like, straight away, yeah, you need a career break big time. You need to get out of the public eye. You need to go in and find out what it is like to be a human being.
Yeah.
You know, get a bit of reality there before you...
Were you even annoyed? Is it even depressing that you had to get somebody to tell you that? Like you knew that anyway.
I knew, but you have to, I suppose it's just, you know,
To get a sort of confirmation for everybody else involved
exactly,
in the family.
Yeah.
Saying, no, you see,
to get it as a medical diagnosis, yeah, you know. Right. Yeah. It was like, yeah, the depression factor, you know, the isolation, the too much fame, that she needs to go and hang and relax.
Go out on tour for 2 or 3 months and take 2 weeks break. Go back out for 2 months, 3 months, take another couple of weeks off. Time to recharge your batteries. Because if you just get overworked and you're kind of going solid for a full year without a break, you start going off the wall, you know. Just get totally exhausted mentally and physically, and you just don't enjoy it anymore. It shouldn't be like that. We've actually never had an official big fight where the four of us have abused each other and said, I hate you, you know, that kind of thing. Never.
Mike is my brother, so I'm not going to say anything about him.
Ferg is pretty, he's dedicated to what he does, his job, he's a great drummer and all that, and Noel, well, he's my brother, like, so I grew up with him, and he's kind of friend as well.
Except I went to work before he did, so I bought CDs and he just robbed them.
Dolores is very strong, very passionate.
One of them will take someone else's socks, typical boy stuff, like my brother's.
Mike is a bit of a joker, but under it all, he actually is very serious about what he does. And Ferg is an idiot.
We more or less like we'll stick together, you know. We're not ones to be going out partying with all other bands and stuff like that. No, can we just do our own thing, really?
Well, we've spent the last, I suppose, 3 or 4 years on and off together a lot. And we're still good friends, so that's a good sign.
After touring with the third album, To the Faithful Departed, the Cranberries took a long break, and before the release of album number 4 in April 99, they went back out on the road, starting with a few numbers at the Nobel Prize-winning ceremony in the year when the laureates were David Trimble and John Hume in Oslo in December 98.
I've always kind of thought it was a kind of a cool thing, the Nobel Peace Prizes, the whole... When I was a little girl, I remember Mother Teresa getting one of them and stuff, so... It was being played, like, it was a good way to kind of get your first performance kind of exposed. It was being played, I'm sure, all over Europe.
Yeah.
So, it was fun as well. Like, who was there? Phil Collins was there and Alanis Morissette.
He introduced you on stage, yeah.
Yeah, he was very nice. Mm. And Alanis Morissette was there, we didn't see her. And, God, I can't remember now, there was another few artists. Oh, you know, your man from Aha.
Oh,
Martin
right,
Harkett,
yeah.
They were there as well. So it was a bit of a laugh. There was a party afterwards and it was fun. It was all optimistic and, you know, it was a nice cause and stuff. So.
Right. But the audience was a bit of a strange audience to play to, let's be honest.
Yeah, but, you know, it's like in a situation like that, it's kind of like if they're tapping there and they're all in the dicky bus. Actually, it was funny. I was in the elevator and I was coming down, you know, and I was kind of dolled up and ready to go on stage. And somebody says in the elevator, oh, my God, do you know the King is here? And I was there, who, Elvis? I was there, you know. I knew the King of Sweden. And I was like, all right, OK. Right, you know,
that's
like,
where Elvis is hiding out, also.
Right, you know, yeah.
What about the actual getting on the road? I mean, like, is it that the guys get off the stage now and go off somewhere otherwise and you never see them in their own stage the next night?
No, actually, what happens now is, you see, it's okay, we're all in the same boat now. I have a baby, so we got a private jet. So I fly out at lunchtime and I go and I do the gig. Mm. And after the gig, I fly back to Limerick. So I sleep in Ireland every night.
Oh, really?
But every second day I'm in a different country. It's a bit weird on the head, like, 1 minute you're out in the field and... you know, just outside Limerick or whatever, and the next thing, bang, you're in Munich. I was in Munich and I just flew in today. Mm. Tomorrow I'm going to fly out to Hamburg and then I'll be back at home tomorrow night and then I'll have the day after off and then I'll fly out to Berlin. So it's just kind of like you think you're at home and you're driving down the road and you see and it's like, oh, God, I'm in Berlin now, you know, it's kind of... And then you're gone, you're home again. But it's great because your brain just really kind of
slaps.
Are
you happy enough on that jet? I mean, it's very important that the journey is sort of, you know, a relaxed one as well.
Yeah.
Is it?
No, I've become really good. Like, I've become a bit holy now.
Really?
No, honestly, like, it's like you know, when you get the turbulence and stuff, you kind of know, like, when you're going to get it. But I think, like, you know, if you're going to go, you're going to go. And, I mean, you get killed in a bus or across the road or, you know, whatever. Aye. So usually it's grand. I'm used to it. We did the whole American tour in a jet. So, you know, obviously in about 8 weeks, you're going to be flying about, you know, 40 times or something.
Yeah,
it's like
sure,
flying everywhere. Yeah. So you just get used to it.
From small-town Limerick outfit to worldwide fame and fortune, it all seemed to happen in the blink of an eye, as grunge with Nirvana at the front was the coolest thing from America, and Britpop with Blur and Oasis the new happening from Britain, the more ethereal sound of the Cranberries soared above it all, selling out stadiums and selling albums by the truckload. A short time, but a long way from those early Limerick gigs.
Like, do you remember your first gigs? We played you back to the audience all the time.
I remember our first gig in Cruises, yeah. And I just remember, like, going on stage and being really embarrassed and singing six songs. And, you know, it was like I was used to seeing show bands. You know, I'd go to, like, show bands with my parents, like waltzes and stuff. So I was totally into this. Next Little Number Now, folks, is called She'll Be Coming Over the Mountain Next Week. You know, that whole scene, like, I hadn't a clue about, like, you know, the whole rock and roll thing. And I think that kind of stood to me, because then I didn't want to be like any other bands. I'm just going to be Dolores, and it worked, you know. So it's kind of like if you're an intelligent woman and you've got a beautiful voice, there's all these stupid people who don't know how to handle you, because they're used to kind of, you know, in the way in London you have this scene, you've got all these girls who talk about their sexuality and their sex lives 24 hours a day, and they can't sing, but they go to the trendy places and they go out with the guy in the other band that's popular in London, all that scene, you know. And it's like, I'm not a part of that, and I got my own life, and I'm married, and I'm a happy woman, and I write songs because I love writing songs and I love singing. It's very simple. It's just that a lot of guys have big problems with it, like, and they're like, oh, you know, she's weird, you know, she's strange. And they start writing crap then about, you know, it's like, so I just think it's kind of a bit sexist towards women, very sexist towards women, actually.
Well, what about you trying something different? I mean, the Cranberries are the Cranberries, the four of you. You're going to be doing something with Pavarotti now. Now, how does that... does that scare you? Does it frighten you? Does it excite you?
Excites me, yeah. Totally excited about
Without
it.
Without the guys there, like, what are you going to be doing?
He's going to come along to hang out and mind me, babysit me. And we're going to do the Ave Maria together.
The idea, like, of you singing a song like that, people would say, that's second nature to you. Like, you've done that before.
Yeah.
Like, you did that as a child.
It really excites me, because it's something I love doing. And, you know, it's like my career has taken off with the Cranberries, you know, with the rock and roll thing. But still, I do have a great passion for that type of singing. It's more restricted and it's more naked.
Yeah.
Dolores married Don Burton in 1994, the former tour manager with Duran Duran, and before moving to Howth in Dublin in 2005, and from there onto Ontario in Canada, and then back home after the breakup of her marriage back in 2013, the couple lived on a huge stud farm in Kilmallock in County Limerick.
Yeah, it's beautiful there. I bought 300 acres. It's just all fields. It used to be a racetrack. The guy who owned it was into horses, so we have a lot of riding horses and stuff. Yeah. It's kind of got a really good layback-ish unwinding thing, and it's kind of like you could stay there forever, and there's good security and stuff there, so I feel really safe, you know. Right. And it's just really kind of self-contained. There's no reason that I have to go out too much, because obviously you go out when you're working and, you know. So when you're not working, it's nice to stay at home or whatever, you know.
And it's very important for you to be near family.
Yeah. I guess particularly my mom. I'm really close to her. I guess I'd say she's probably my best female friend in the world, which is kind of weird because, I mean, some girls either go the opposite direction to their mothers or some get, like, sisters. And my mom is just, like, we're really close. She's always been there, you know. And when I went through that really difficult time, she was there for me and she pulled me through, you know, and... You know, it's good if you have that, you know, because then you have your kids and you got total support. It's really nice to have that.
When you play big festivals and stuff like that in the States, do you hang out for the day? I mean, do you hang out with other bands? Do you check them out and do you go to their part of the ground and see what they're up to or whatever?
No, we're a bit boring that way.
Are you?
We never go to celebrity parties or anything like that. I much prefer to go down to the local pub and talk to Paddy and ask him how his cow's mastitis or something. I just find it more real. I find celebrity parties, there's an awful lot of... It's like you get a lot of people acting like kids or something trying to show off to each other who's cooler than who. Mm. See, now I don't really get that. I much prefer, as I said, to go down to the pub and, you know, talk to a few of the local heads, you know. And to me, that's grounding, that's reality. See, because I think you can get sucked into that whole going to all the parties and da-da-da. Well, look, that's Blau over there, and she's good-looking in real life, you know, whatever. Mm. But no, never. And the band aren't either. We've never been into that, you know. It's like, obviously, you do meet a few bands that you'll admire and you think they're sound, and, you know, when you meet them, you'll have a chat and a beer or whatever, but we're usually like, you know, let's get on the bus and we have our own little party, you know, and we hang around with our crew a lot.
Right, yeah. OK, but if you do that then, I mean, you didn't even... Like, if when you were in between album number 3 and number 4 and things were going wrong, you didn't even want to do that, did you? There was no fun, no socialising at all. You didn't...
No.
It was just... You wanted to just... You wanted that padded cell, maybe.
Yeah, probably. Give me a padded cell and I'd beat my head off the wall. No, but, yeah, no, because we've never really got into all that stuff. And I know it's a big scene, the celebrity scene. And, you know, I think, obviously, when you open certain magazines... Blah, blah, at this party with blah, blah, and yeah. Blah, blah is with blah, blah. And it's like, we're never in those because we never do it, you know, we just go home. And I think it's nice because people know that you're pretty grounded and you're normal and you're not like, well, I'm a big star man, you know.
Yeah.
You're just normal enough, but that's what you do. You make music, you write songs, you tour. That's your job, but it doesn't really go beyond that.
Song Promises,
yeah.
Which, as you say, they're all singing along to now, no problem. Was that written at the time of or about divorce or about the fact that when divorce comes into Ireland or what is it exactly?
Yeah, it was around that time. And I guess, like, having spent so much time and stuff in America, I'd be tooting my horn. Well, Ireland, we have no divorce and we have no, and it's so perfect, you know. So then I come home and it's like, divorce man in Ireland, wow. And I know it's a good thing, it is, because, I mean, it's my psychologist there. It's my shrink. It's okay, I'm doing okay, I'm coping with this interview. Do-be-duck, 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 do-be-duck.